The praise has been incredible this evening, and those encouragements were really great. As Bella was just sharing, I just felt the Lord reminding me of one of the truths I've learnt over the last few years, which is, you know, I so long for certainty and don't get, you know, some of the answers to the questions that I have and the certainty that I want. But the gift that the Lord often gives to us is the ability to trust Him. And as you've held on over those 2 years for a breakthrough, eventually it's come. And I suspect you've learned a huge amount during those 2 years of frustration and disappointment as well. And just Elliot, where's Elliot gone? He's in disguise, so it's just a toilet. Oh, got a prophetic word from him. It's hopeless. Well, he might come back and I might give it to him in a moment or two. But just I'm really excited as well, as Tim was saying, about the Pentecost weekend that's coming up soon. And I can see a number of chaps around here. And I think one of the great privileges is that we have on the day of the Pentecost celebration and what's happening during that day with Splendor is in the evening, of course, we all get to go there. But during the daytime, the men often can't make it because it's just for women. But one of the ways you can get there as a man is to serve. And I think one of the strengths of this church is determined by our ability as men to serve the women in the life of this church. And we do actually need chaps to come and serve and to make this great event run as smoothly as possible. And if you can give any time to serve, to bless, to encourage the women at Splendor, then in the news sheet, you'll see that there's a little note there about Splendor. If you could just email and let Rich Byatt know, come see Tim, Gareth or I, give us your name, then we'd love to connect with you and have you as part of the team that we're a part of as well on what will be an amazing event. So if you could do that, that would be fantastic. Also, I don't know if you've been aware this weekend, I mean, if you're not into sport at all, then you will not be aware that this has been a weekend of titanic struggles. Enormous struggles as Real Madrid, the star show of football, took on the minnows, that is Atletico Madrid, and there was this titanic struggle as Real Madrid came through. And down at the Millennium Stadium yesterday afternoon, the world stars of rugby, Toulon, led by Johnny Wilkinson, who was playing his last game in this country, savaged Saracens, who are known as the Wolf Pack. And then today, England, we've been completely stuffed by Sri Lanka at cricket. On and on it goes. Hamilton and Rosberg sort of battled it out on the streets of Monaco in the Grand Prix. And the other day, QPR beat Derby in the wealthiest, sort of richest match, football match in sporting history. And so there are these sort of struggles that go on around us in the sporting world. There are these struggles that go on in and around us in every realm of life. And last weekend, as Tim, Elliot, just as you come in, quickly stand there. I just got a word for you and I don't want to forget it, okay? I felt like, we'll come back to the series in a moment, but I just felt like the Lord say to me that he'd anointed you with a favor and a grace and a winsomeness, that he would use you to draw others to him. And I saw it resting on you as you were standing up here, and that there was a preparedness on your part to connect with people and to do whatever it took to connect with people, and the Lord would bless that and honor that, and that he was giving you eyes to see the needs of people around you, that you'd be able to bless them and minister them to that. So that's for you. Lord bless him. That's off my chest. That's for him to carry now. And we're into this little series here called Preview, as Tim was saying, and we're basically looking over 3 weeks at certain miracles in Matthew 8. If you've got a Bible, you may want to turn there, okay? Because these miracles, these events, give us a little glimpse, as it were, a little peep behind the curtain of coming attractions, of what's coming. And as we think about titanic struggles, here we are this evening with a front row seat as Jesus is going to demonstrate his power over spiritual forces. So last weekend we had a front row seat in the morning, not in the evening, because we had Miriam Swaffield here. A front row seat as Jesus demonstrated his power over the physical body. But here we are in Matthew 8, and I just want to read a few verses out of Matthew 8, beginning at verse 28, where it says this. Matthew says this: "When he arrived at the other side in the region of the Gadarenes, two demon-possessed men came from the tombs to meet him. They were so violent that no one could pass that way. 'What do you want with us, Son of God?' they shouted. 'Have you come here to torture us before the appointed time?' Now, if you were to flip over into Mark's gospel, Jesus actually describes one of these demon-possessed men, and he says this man, his name was Legion, lived in the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Day at night and day amongst the tombs and in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with stones. Now, if this is the opening scene of a movie, then this is a pretty jaw-dropping scene, if I'm being honest. You know, we've got two grown men running around stark naked, and Matthew uses the word violent to describe them here, okay? They've got chains hanging off of them, their skin, you know, their bodies have been mutilated and lacerated by self-destructive practices. And in the middle of this sort of frenzied, foaming, sort of raving, lunatic sort of madness, they are rushing around. And then they come, that they sort of get stopped in their tracks as they encounter Jesus and they stare him face to face. And it must be one of those moments where the hairs on the back of your neck would stand up as you're watching it. And Jesus sort of stands there and looks at them and says, "Hey guys, remember me? Long time no see." What separates this scene from any scene in a movie like Paranormal Activity or the Devil Wears Prada type movie is in fact that this really happened. And maybe the devil does wear Prada. I've got no idea. I'm pretty sure that Paris Hilton does, and that's pretty close second. But that's a joke, don't worry. What I do know is that Jesus encountered two people who had demons living in them. And this is still real today. So what I want to do really this evening is to try and walk through scripture with you. But I want to talk, first of all, not about demon possession. I will get to that in a moment. We don't do that very often here, but I'm going to get there. I want to talk about the reality of demons. When God created the universe, he created a visible reality and an invisible reality. That which we can see with the human eye and that which we cannot see with the human eye. And what most people ignore or deny today in our civilized Western culture, you know, is that the visible reality and the invisible reality are equally true. And as part of that invisible reality, God created angels. And though we are different from angels as human beings, we are equally real. Angels are as real as you and I are real. As we're sitting here in this room today, in the reality of this moment, they are as real as we are real here. And so for those of you that are taking notes, and I don't think I've ever done this before in this place, you know, I just want to say a little bit about what the Bible has to say about angels. And you will understand why in a moment or two. But here's the first thing. Angels are spiritual beings. The substance they're made of is a spiritual substance. It's different from the material, sort of physical sort of substance that God used to compose us, but they are equally as real. Secondly, angels are powerful beings. You know, what separates angels from us is that they can perform miracles. You know, they are more powerful than we are. And they can appear in both realities. They can appear in the invisible reality and the visible reality. We can't, at least not yet. Angels as well, thirdly, are immortal. Angels are created beings like we are. That they are not inherently immoral like we are. God has given them this gift of immortality. So they will never face death like us. They will live forever and ever and ever in one of two destinations, either heaven or hell. Now, the Bible describes, if you don't know this, different types of angels, three different types of angels, and each has a distinct purpose. First of all, there is the cherubim. And the cherubim in our culture, you know, if you look at sort of postcards or sort of see sort of cartoon sort of type characters, are typically described as these chubby-cheeked little babies who float around on clouds playing harps. You've seen the sort of pictures, you've got the picture, okay? They are anything but that. They are these winged creatures, okay? And that is true, but they are fierce. God used the cherubim, first of all, to oversee and to protect the Garden of Eden once he'd removed Adam and Eve from it. He used the cherubim to protect the Ark of the Covenant, you know, in the Holy of Holies. I doubt whether, if we stuck to biblical pictures, you would want to use pictures of cherubim in your children's nursery, for instance, because it might scare them, it might really freak them out. He also used, they're also used to describe in poetic terminology in the Old Testament, that which God used for transportation. He used the cherubim to get around the heavenlies. The second category is the seraphim, and the word seraph means burning ones or glowing ones. And any time these six-winged creatures are described in Scripture, they're always in the throne room of God. They're always in his presence. They're worshiping him night and day. And holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is and is to come. So that's the second category. The third are the archangels. And the Bible talks about lots of different purposes for angels. Some, you know, are said to be there to bring, are sent to bring messages to us. Others are sent to minister to us at difficult times. The archangels have a very distinct purpose. The archangels lead God's other warring angels. Warring angels, okay? In battle against evil, bless you, on a regular basis. And these are the angels who will accompany Christ when he returns to this planet. We've been singing about your kingdom come, your will be done. You know, we're anticipating that moment that is coming when Christ returns. And in Scripture, we're given specific names for two specific archangels. They are on polar opposite extremes of our understanding of God and our relationship with him. One is Michael, and the second is Lucifer. Now, I know I'm being a little bit technical just for a moment or two, but bear with me. You know, this is important. Like people, God gave his angels free will. Angels are not robotic in their decision-making, meaning that they're not hardwired by God to inherently obey God. Obedience is a choice for angels, just like it's a choice for us. Before you and I were ever born into this visible reality, a major war took place in the invisible reality where Lucifer, one of the archangels, you know, decided that he wanted to be elevated to a position where he was co-equal with God, and it's described in Isaiah and Ezekiel. And the problem with Lucifer's plan is that God is the creator and Lucifer is part of the creation. So that it means he can never be co-equal with God because he's just not capable of fulfilling that role. So at every level, at every scale, at every standard, you know, Lucifer is a lesser being than God. So God in his infinite holiness is put into this position where he has to expel Lucifer from his presence. And in that process, Lucifer convinces other angels to join him in this rebellion. We don't know quite how many, but a number followed him. And Revelation 12:4 says that a third of the angels followed him. And when Lucifer was expelled from heaven, God gave him a new name, and that name is Satan. And that word means accuser. That's not just his title, by the way. That describes his function. And every day he goes before God and he accuses you and he accuses me and our own conscience of sin of which we have already been forgiven. And the angels that chose to follow Lucifer were also given a new name as well, and that name is demon. And Satan and his demon army were given the exact agenda that they've always had since that rebellious day, which is to convince each one of us, each and every one of us, that we don't need God, first of all, and secondly, that we are equal to God. Those are his two, those are the two distinct purposes, you know, in the day-to-day. And Revelation 12:7 describes this fallout with God very, very clearly. And it says this, okay, I just want to read this to you, okay, that there was war in heaven. This is huge. This is really significant, okay. When I was reading this earlier on in my my little study at home, my little box room at home, my hands were shaking as I read this. Okay, this is huge. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, the ancient snake called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth and his angels with him. So here, what we see here is this demonstration of God's power, okay? We need to remember as we look at this, as we think about this, as we do this series, that God is in control. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters, that's us, okay? He accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. They, that's us, that's we, overcame him not by anything that we could do, but by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. But they did not love their life so much as to shrink from death. See, we should not be afraid of death. And I'll get back to that in a moment, Sue. Therefore, rejoice, you heavens, and you who already have God and dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury. You need to notice that, okay? Because he knows that his time is short. In other words, my translation of this is, first of all, we need to understand that demons are doomed. Their destination has already been predetermined by God. And Jesus approaches these two guys who have multiple demons oppressing them, living within them. And they say to him, have you come to torture us before our appointed time? Now, that last phrase is really important there. They know that their days are numbered. They know Jesus. He's no stranger to them. You know, they've seen him before. You know, they've lived in God's presence with him. And they know, they actually know that there's a day coming when Jesus will no longer allow them to pursue or torment or tempt or confuse or occupy and destroy the human condition. But until that day, until that judgment day, all of us need to be reminded of this truth, that demons are not only doomed, but secondly, demons can be dangerous. So picking up in verse 30, some distance from them, a large herd of pigs were feeding. The demons begged Jesus, if you drive us out, send us into the herd of pigs. He said to them, go. Actually, in the Greek, the translation is, you may go. He gives them permission to go. So they came out, went into the pigs, and the whole herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and died in the water. Now, I don't know, whatever phrases you use to describe this scene, here's what you need to remember. Wherever demons go, death follows. That's what makes them dangerous. Do you know, where there's a life, they want to bring the opposite, they want to bring death. So I heard a story a little while ago about a guy who was working in an orphanage in Taiwan. And in this orphanage, it was not uncommon for people who lived near that orphanage to drop off babies at the gate of this orphanage, you know, but it was very uncommon for them to drop off a teenager. And one afternoon, they opened up the gates, and where they would often sort of perhaps find babies, they just saw this unresponsive teenage girl standing there. And on her jumper, pinned to her jumper, was a little note with her name on it, and underneath it just said, I have been abused by men. She was catatonic. It's the only word that could describe her. And each evening, as the people around her read their Bibles and they prayed with the other children in the orphanage, she would sit in the corner of this room alone with her head tucked between her knees, not wanting to interact or associate with anybody. It was just tragic. And they had to watch over and they had to look after and keep an eye on her day after day after day. You need to know as an aside that isolation is a tactic of demons. Because demons know that isolation drains the life out of a person. So here's a thought, just as an aside, as people in this community that want to make a difference in this community. If you see a teenager, or anyone just pulling up a hood over their head and hiding themselves away, wanting to distance themselves from family or friends, we actually need to pay attention there. We really do. So this guy who's telling this story is just deeply moved by what he's experienced, by what he's encountered out in Taiwan. It was his first, he said, real exposure to the work of demons. And And I just remember him saying that he would never forget what happened, you know, where a group of people gathered around this girl and had a prayer meeting for her and prayed deliverance over her, prayed on her behalf. And he said, I'll never forget her eyes regaining focus and her skin's color returning, and watching her collapse as she encountered the love of Jesus and as she was set free, collapsing into the loving arms of one of the house mums who sort of cared for the children in this place. And then he said, hearing this sweet teenage voice emerge from this girl for the very first time, where up until that point, if there'd been anything, it was a deep sort of degrading voice that spoke on her behalf. This guy just said that it was a life-changing experience for him. Friends, you know, you need to know that we here at Trinity, we believe, you know, we are with Revelation 12. It's true, it's real. We are at war. Paul says in Ephesians 6, doesn't he, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And most people today in our culture, very often in the church even as well, want to believe that the war is limited to what we can see, to the visible reality, to flesh and blood. You know, the culture we live in believes that evil is a result of bad social systems or bad economic policies or bad government decisions or bad education or bad parenting or perhaps bad brain chemistry. And so the consensus solution of our culture is that, hey, if we can fix all these bad things, then we can eliminate all the bad things that go on in our world. Friends, ultimately what that pervasive belief does is it limits the battle and the enemy to just what we can see, to the visible reality, to flesh and blood. And my problem with that paradigm for evil is that we live in a very educated culture. You know, this culture that we're a part of is more educated than any culture in the history of humanity. You know, and the more we understand and the more we counsel and the more we treat and the more we medicate and the more we rehabilitate and the more programs and initiatives that we launch, you know, to eradicate evil in this world, you know. And don't get me wrong, I'm all for those things. I really am. If it's just a flesh and blood battle, though, then those things should go away. That is the logic of that mindset. For, you know, if we can do those things, there shouldn't be any evil in the near future. You know, we should be able to go home this evening and sit on our patios, you know, drinking rosé, reminiscing about the good old days. Do you know, remember the good old days in our country when people carried knives? Like this horrendous thing in America that's happened recently, you know, people carry guns. If that mindset is true, if it's just flesh and blood, we should be able to sit there drinking our wine or tea or whatever it is you drink, you know, and just say, hey, do you remember the times when the United Kingdom had nuclear missiles and we had to have peace treaties with sort of aggressive countries? Or do you remember in those good old days when we used to build prisons for the people that abused people or attacked people or committed crimes or abducted others? Do you remember those good old days when we had anti-drug sort of campaigns, just say no? But nobody was able to say no in those days, so we had to have all these clinics everywhere. Did you remember those good old days? You see, friends, if evil is a thing of the past, you know, because we're becoming more aware, that then I have to say this, then we should actually feel more safe and secure than we did when we were kids, those of us that are older. But I bet there are very few of us that feel safer today than we did 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 40 years ago, depending on how old we are. And could it be that the reason we don't feel more safe or more secure than we did yesterday is because the battle is more than flesh and blood? There is a reality out there that we have to embrace. And if we, here's the thing, if we don't embrace the demonic world, then we don't embrace Jesus. Friends, you know, he confronted them again and again. He spoke to Satan directly 25 times. This is real. Mike Fuller, who was preaching on this morning in an excellent sort of message, produced all sorts of statistics that were sort of overpowering, but basically pointing out that most people in the West basically believe in God. I don't know where the figures came from, but basically the statistic I read recently is only 33% of people believe in the devil. Do you know what? He really likes that. He really likes that. You know, C.S. Lewis once said, Mike quoted this morning, we quote this on the Alpha Course, which is so helpful as we explore this sort of area. There are two equal and opposite extremes into which people can fall as it relates to demons. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to have an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. The demons are equally pleased with both errors. Years ago, when we lived in Norwich, there was a guy there who worked for youth, the YMCA, and he was involved in accommodating and housing and caring for young people in that city. And we knew him from the church, and he worked there, and I went in there quite often. And this young guy was knifed once, stabbed to the heart, and killed. And the guy who murdered this member of our church family was a guy who'd been left by his father, had lived with his drug-using mother, and had had siblings that he tried to look after himself. And I think that most people, as I reflect on that, who were involved in his life in some way or another, whether it was sports coaches, social workers, teachers, or whatever, you know, knew that something bad was probably going to happen in his life. And I remember the public outcry. I remember the press. I remember the church family being deeply upset and deeply moved. I remember reading the local papers, even watching the local news, and people using phrases to describe this guy that committed this crime. They described him as an animal after he'd committed this murder, after he'd stabbed this guy. And I mean, the truth is that it was a tragedy, of course, and yet I struggled with how that one decision had seemingly wrecked his life. Do you know, I struggled to reconcile what he did in that moment and what was said about him with the shy, soft-spoken guy that I'd met down at the YMCA on a reasonably regular basis. I remember after he'd been convicted, going to visit him in prison and chatting to him. And as we talked, he just kept saying, "I'm sorry. I'm sorry." Do you know, I remember him saying, I don't remember. I just don't remember. I don't remember what happened before. I don't remember what happened afterwards. You know, I don't remember stabbing him." Friends, you know, you just need to understand that wherever demons go, death follows. Revelation 12 is right. We are at war. I've heard stories, you've probably heard stories from people who've lived out in places like Haiti, who've seen voodoo witch doctors get beaten up with machetes, who would come out unscathed without a scratch, you know, without a drop of blood, exiting their bodies. On Easter Sundays, they mocked the death of Jesus. You know, I've talked to people who've seen men and women in demonic trances eat and chew entire glass bottles without any physical ill effects. I've heard about sort of crowds of people, mobs of people that were so frenzied that as they ran, the ground shook, as it were, and as they would sort of beat up and cut up people without any conscience at all. Why? Because this battle is not just flesh and blood. We are at war, and people's eternities, their lives, are at stake. You know, we're battling against, the Paul says, the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. We cannot see, but we need to know that they're real. And even though the presence of Satan and his demon army may not seem as overt or as visible in Cheltenham or in our culture as it is in a place like Haiti, friends, the result of their work, if we look around us, is all around us. Look no further than the breakdown of familial life in our culture. I don't care what the media says. We need to know that we're not going to fall because of some, as a nation, because of some sort of external known adversary. We will fall because of an invisible, unknown, unacknowledged adversary. You study what's happening in the divorce courses, in the divorce courts, with child custody, with abuse cases. It's a little bit, I don't know if you know your World War II history, but it's a little bit like the invasion of Pearl Harbor. You know, apparently the American forces were recovering from a Saturday night of hard partying on that Sunday morning. The admiral, was out on the golf course playing golf, and while everyone slept or recovered or played golf on the golf course, the Japanese declared a silent war. They sent planes with kamikaze pilots to Pearl Harbor with the intention of destroying the American Pacific Fleet. I just want to remind you that we're at war here. We're at war. But sometimes it feels like only the enemy knows it. And we have to wake up to what's going on in our culture, what's happening in family and life, in and around us. You know, it's like Satan and his crowd. They have declared war on us. And the truth is that we cannot win a war unless we know the war exists. We cannot defeat an enemy if we pretend that there isn't an enemy. We need to face the facts that we are at war. Now, apparently, after the raid on Pearl Harbor, the Japanese admiral said, "I fear we have awakened a sleeping giant." Hopefully, in our case, that sleeping giant is a sleeping beauty, as it were, the bride of Christ. Maybe, hopefully, the bride of Christ in this community could be awoken. The church could be awoken. Maybe we'll be awoken by the bombs of spiritual destruction that are being dropped around us, all around us. Friend, we need to treat every day of our existence like we are at war. I love the Message version of 1 Peter 5 where it says this: keep a cool head. Don't panic, Captain Mannering. Keep a cool head, stay alert. The devil is poised to pounce and would like nothing more than to catch you now, so keep your guard up. So let me say this. Wherever death goes, demons follow, okay? And here's how they bring death into a person's living. First of all, demons will manipulate your mind. When you expose your mind to unhealthy images or unhealthy ideas, it could be through movies, it could be through music, it could be through video games, it could be anything. You are turning all the neural pathways, all your neural pathways into an 8-lane superhighway for the demons to deliver their destructive messages. So John chapter 8 says that he, Satan, was a murderer from the beginning. Here's the thing, he doesn't have our best interests at heart, the enemy. Hell is not going to be some party that those that go there are going to enjoy. He's a murderer from the beginning, not holding the truth, because there's no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. He wants to manipulate our minds, your mind, my mind, with lies about relationships. He wants to manipulate our minds with lies about the truth, about anything he can. So friends, if you dabble with tarot cards, Ouija boards, Dungeons and Dragons, games like that, that sort of witchcraft, seances, pornography, drugs. Let me just say this. I'm not saying this in an accusing way, but you are opening the front door of your mind and you're inviting the demons to exert their influence in your thought life. If you have damaged emotions, and most of us do, from something perhaps that you've done to yourself or something that someone has done to you, and you've not sought help for those painful experiences, it's very easy if you do that to place a welcome mat outside the front door of your mind. That's inviting the father of lies to fill your mind with manipulative statements. You know what I'm talking about when he whispers these sort of things into your mind. You'll never amount to anything. You're not smart enough, you're not pretty enough, you're not beautiful enough, you're not good enough to measure up, there's no hope for you, you're nothing more than damaged goods. That's his voice, that's not your own voice, that's his voice. You see, what he wants to do is he wants to plant thoughts in your mind that are not your thoughts. He wants to convince you that they are your thoughts. And here's why, because the enemy loves nothing more than piggybacking off a person's damaged emotions or traumatic memories that wreak havoc in our thought lives. And the demonic activity that I've seen in the lives of others and that I've seen in my own life seems to come down to this very simple, basic principle. Garbage in, garbage out. Rubbish in, rubbish out. One of the names for the devil in the Bible is Beelzebub. And that word means Lord of the Flies. You know, it's just like flies are attracted to rubbish, okay? Demons are attracted to the spiritual and the emotional garbage in people's lives. So when an individual person realizes that the main problem in their life is not demonic activity, but it's the garbage that they're storing in their hearts and minds, that is a great day. That is a good day. Because if you expose your mind to the truth, you can experience freedom from the bondage that we find ourselves in. Friends, I want you to hear this, okay? If the demon's primary weapon is a lie, our primary defense is the truth. I've thought about this quite a bit, and by and large, I want to say that dealing with a demon is not a power encounter. It's primarily a truth encounter. So when Paul says, when you realize that the war is not just flesh and blood, but it's a spiritual battle, what does he say the next step is? He says it's to stand firm with the belt of truth buckled round your waist. Now what does that look like? Well, let me say this. You are what you think. Your mind is the battlefield. And the strategic high ground that the enemy wants to take from you is your thought life, which is why Paul says in Philippians 4, okay, friends, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, anything that is excellent or praiseworthy, those are the things that we should think about. And the most important truth that you should think about every day, or at least remind yourself every day of, is this, that you're a child of God. That you're a son of God, that you're a daughter of God. You know, that's the one thing he wants to rob you of. You know, and all the privileges and joys and delights that go with that inheritance. You're a child of God. I heard a marvelous story a little while ago about a guy called Fred Craddock, who was a preacher man. He went on holiday with his wife, and because he was a preacher man, a pastor man, he wanted to get away from people. And he found himself going off to a little restaurant, a quiet little restaurant, and found a little sort of side sort of annex where he could sit with his wife. And they sat down and they were beginning a conversation when this guy came up to them and interrupted their conversation and said, "Are you on holiday?" And they said, "Yeah, we are," in the hope that he might leave. He didn't. He just pulled a chair up and sat down with them and said, "So what do you do for a living?" And the guy who was the preacher man was trying to fob him off, and he said, "Well, you know, I'm a professor of homiletics," which I know sounds cool, and this guy was too clever to be fobbed off. He said, "Oh, so you're a preacher man." He said, "I've got a preacher story." Everyone's got a preacher story, actually. "Let me tell you my preacher story." And Craddock wrote this, okay? He said, this guy who sat down with him, he said, "You know, I was born without a dad in my life. I never knew who my dad was. It was really hard on me because I never knew who my father was. And the boys at school used to tease me. And as I used to walk through the town, people used to make fun of me. And I used to feel that people would stare at me because there was this question over my life, you know, who was my father? And so I would often find myself in isolation, and I didn't have very many friends. And then one day a preacher man came to town, and everybody was talking about how good this preacher man was. And I'd never been to church before, because no one had ever invited me. He said, "But I heard about this preacher man, so I went to hear him, and he was so nice and he was so good, and I used to go back Sunday after Sunday, but I had a little trick." He said, "Before he finished, I used to get up and sneak out so that I wouldn't get caught by anybody. But then one day the preacher's message was so good, and as he was praying, I got so caught up in what was doing that I lost all sense of time and position. And before I knew it, he prayed the blessing and people were going out, and I couldn't leave the building. And suddenly I felt this hand on my shoulder, and I turned around, and it was the preacher man, and he said, what's your name then? And whose boy are you? Fred Craddock said, I shook from head to toe and I didn't know how to answer that question. Before I could say anything, it was like the preacher man knew. And he sat down next to me and he said, you know, I know who you are. You're God's son. You're his child. In fact, as I look at you, I can see a really strong family resemblance. You look just like your father in heaven. And as those words came off that preacher's tongue, he looked at Fred Craddock and his wife. He said, those words changed my life. That guy just got up and he walked out. The guy that had told the story, the waitress came up a few minutes later and said, do you know who that was? And I said, no, who was it? And the waitress said, and this won't mean anything to you, but apparently his name was Ben Hooper. He was the two-term governor of the state of Tennessee. Do you know, we need to be reminded that we're children of God. And because of that, we have a high standard. I'm nearly there. Well, let me just say this really briefly. Not only will demons manipulate your minds to convince you that you are of the I am, that we are of no value, but demons will weaken your will. You see, demons are not, that they're not, we need to understand this, they're not all-knowing like God. But to tempt us, they sometimes feel like they are. Sometimes it feels like they've been able to read our mail. But they don't have to be all-knowing. All we have to do is say bad stuff, do bad stuff again, to expose where we are spiritually weak. And the choices that we make are like sort of flashing neon signs over our lives, that stand above our heads, and they reveal to the demonic world where we're vulnerable, where we're spiritually vulnerable. I was talking to somebody a couple of weeks ago who'd just fallen into involvement with pornography. And they said this, you know, I felt confused by the person I'd become. I felt like I had become spiritually schizophrenic. I was absolutely confused by the lack of control in my life. And they said this, Mark, my mistake was that I didn't get help. I didn't acknowledge my problem until one day I found myself in a club and I found myself sitting on the front row getting money out of my pocket to give to the girls that were dancing in front of me. See, when it comes to the work of the enemy in our lives, if you give them a foothold, they will turn it into a stronghold. If you give them an inch, they will take a mile every time. So the writer of Hebrews says this, okay, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to feel sympathy for our weaknesses, but, hallelujah, we have one who's been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he was without sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we might find mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Listen, we do not find condemnation when we go to Jesus. We're going to find grace. We're going to find love. We're going to find understanding. We're going to find forgiveness. Do you know, Jesus faced every temptation, every weakness that you and I wrestle with. And the reason he was able to overcome these weaknesses and not give in to temptation was that he didn't try and fight the battles with willpower alone. Friends, you know, willpower is no power. Real power is found in prayer. And so Paul says this, okay, after you acknowledge the fact that this is not a flesh and blood battle, but after you put that buckle of truth on your belt, you take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. You know, who struggles with temptation here? Who feels weak at times? You know, we need to cry out, as the psalmist said, you know, Psalm 91, you're my refuge. You know, I'm going to trust in you. You know, I am safe in you, because he wants to rescue us. He wants to save us from the hidden traps. He wants to shield us from deadly habits and use his huge outstretched arms to protect us and to love us and to bring us to a place of safety and security. So truth and prayer, they are the two big weapons. Finally, not only will these demons manipulate your minds and try and weaken your will, but here's the last one. Demons will bully your body. Matthew 8, The men that Jesus helped were cutting themselves. They were abusing their bodies. And friends, if demons can't make us physically sick, they will perhaps try and convince us to, they do at times, to physically hurt ourselves, whether that's pulling out your hair, eating disorders, cutting yourself, suicidal thoughts, sleeplessness, depression, panic attacks, whatever, on it goes. These are the tactics that the enemy can use at times to bully your physical body. If you don't believe me, read the book of Job someday, all right? And if the enemy can't take you out physically or convince you to physically harm your own body, he will enlist other people to do it in your life. And he will make you believe that you deserved it. Why do I say that? Because that's what they tried to do to Jesus. They punched him. They hit him with rods. They put a crown of thorns on his head and they wrenched the thorns into his scalp, and eventually they nailed him to two beams of wood and they drove a spear into his side to try and convince him that he couldn't bring salvation to the world. And the truth is, friends, and I've been needing to say this for some time again, we're at war. But the war has been won. And for 3 days, the devil and his demon army danced. They gloated. They waved their flags of victory. They pointed. They laughed. They held their heads up high, and they declared in the heavenlies that God had been defeated. But it was a premature victory, because on the third day, God stopped their marching band. He stopped their party. He smashed their party. And he said, wherever demons go, death will no longer follow them. That is the message of Easter. You see, death was the greatest weapon in the arsenal of the devil and his demon entourage, and it has been taken from them forever. So I want to say this as I wrap it up now. Let them prowl around. Let them roar. Because Jesus has actually declawed them. He's pulled out their teeth. And as the Bible teaches us in 1 John 4, greater is he that is in us than the one who is in the world. Where, O death, is your sting, says Paul. Where, O death, is your victory? It has been swallowed up in the grave of Jesus Christ. But you need to know this. When you arm yourself with truth and prayer, and this last one, which is authority, and it's resurrection authority, demons actually don't stand a chance against us. Because friends, if God has removed death from the picture, really, what do we have to be afraid of? So like it was said of Jesus, maybe it's said of us, that wherever Trinityites go, we take life. Wherever Trinityites go, we celebrate life. Life follows us wherever we go, and we give it to those who need it most, those that are in need, that are around us in this community and beyond. Amen. Let's stand, shall we?